these guys to each stand up. And they'll be given 3 minutes for an introductory speech. Candidate will draw the number one spot, start there, and then they're going to go on down. We've got that on a timer, and we'll finish with that. So we'll go all the way through everybody. And then I have some questions right after that, that some people who could not be here tonight had dropped some questions off, and I'll be asking those of the candidates. And I don't remember how many I have, just a few. And then we're going to go to the public, where we're going to open it up. And if you want to ask a certain candidate a question, go ahead and say their name and ask the question. If you want to apply it to all of them, then what we'll do is we'll probably start back on that end and have them answer, each of them answer, give you an answer back to your question all the way to this end. Okay? Any questions? Oh, and I forgot to thank Laura for this nice opportunity. At first I said no. Then I changed my mind. So, anyway, first on the list for 3 minutes speech is Larry Wright.
Otherwise, I've lived here all my life. The reason I am running and I also applied for this interim position is number one, because I'm too old to work construction anymore. My body hurts all the time. And number two is I see a lot of young people from families returning to the county, and I would like them and their kids to have the opportunity to grow up in a county that was well run as the county was when I was young. Processes were gone through the proper way, and people were listened to, and nothing happened behind closed doors. I'm completely for open government, and I'm more than willing to listen to any suggestions, and I don't have an axe to grind, I don't have a vendetta. I'm simply for the process of better and more open government. And the thing that people need to remember most when you are an elected official is that you work for the taxpayers. You're there to serve the taxpayers. You're not there to serve special interest groups or small groups or your own personal gain. That's the reason why I'm running and why I applied for this position.
Hello, my name is Bill Amsby, and I'm a Montana native. I've lived in Broward County for 20 years. I have donated my time, money, and resources, and equipment to help our community out. I do tree trimming, roofing, siding, and construction. This job has been great for me. I have met a lot of wonderful people and made many friends. Some of our main topics we discuss is local politics. In my job, you have an end goal, finishing the job. There are many changes along the way. The weather, air materials, equipment, breakdowns. You have to be versatile to make decisions. I don't have any personal agenda. I'm here to look out for Broadwood Academy. I'm very open-minded. Broadwood Academy has to be able to advance, but we need to be responsible. The commissioners have a very hard decision to make. They both have to agree on a candidate. There needs to be three people to break the tie, or not much county business will be done. The commissioners were voted in by the community to make the decisions for you. I would like to thank you for coming and showing your support.
I'm Bill Off the Grove, and I think I'm going to spend my time telling you who I am so you know me a little bit better. I'm married to Barb for 32 years, my best friend. I've got two adult boys that are both married. One of them made me a grandpa last week. I work for McKinstry as a project director, and in that job I develop all over the state for large public sector bodies infrastructure improvements that don't use new taxpayer dollars. In that job, I am required to work with lots of state and county governments. I want you to know that if I am appointed for the interim commissioner job, that I'm going to retire from my McKinstry job so I can give full-time attention to Broadwater County. In my job, I have to build teams, work with budgets, do financial projections, personnel reviews. Also, my background is a civil engineer, so I do a lot of, in my training, road construction, surveying, bridges, all useful things that are a commissioner's job in this county. I want you to know that I personally love the Lord, and that's important to me because I am the church council chair at Trailhead, and with that, you can find me there almost every Sunday teaching Sunday school. I think that's hugely important because I've been gifted with administrative skills, but when it comes to getting the two commissioners to work together, I think I have the patience and the conciliatory ability to help them work together. I'm on the hospital operational board. That's not the same as the district board that's elected. The district board is the one that gets the money from the county and gives it to the hospital. I believe that community participation is hugely important, showing your commitment to Broadwater County. As such, I've been a member of Rotary, and on Rotary, I've not only cooked a million bratwursts, but I've helped donate the money to make the tree covers, put up Christmas tree lights. I'm involved with the Christmas dinner that we sponsor and helping organize that. And the last couple things about me that you might want to know, I have an experimental vineyard in Broadwater County, and that experimental vineyard, if it should work out, would be a good business opportunity for Broadwater County. The last thing I'd want you to know about me is I play hockey a couple times a week to stay in shape, and so I will be representing Helena at the Senior Olympics in a couple weeks, and I hope somebody will ask me why I think I should go after the commissioner position, but my time's up.
My name is Nick Korthals. I've been here for roughly about 14 years. I've been married to Janaea Korthals Pryor Wenzel for 15 years. And I'm going to get in trouble later. But I spent 13 years in this community and in the sheriff's office. I ended my career as a captain. I've also sat on the board. Appointed board by the governor for helping youth, and I've started and was very successful with the DARE program here in Broadwater County. The reason why I'm running for commissioner is because my whole life in Broadwater County has been surrounded and focused on our youth making this a better community for our youth. I feel, and I know, that I possess the abilities to move that on to the entire community, not just our teens and our youth. I have the capability and knowledge. My first year as captain, I saved roughly $80,000 in budget by switching from hospital meals going to Quick Chill. So I do understand what it takes to run a business. Not only that, in the 13 years of my career as a in the law enforcement, I've wrote and managed over $500,000 worth of grants, saving our community money, as well as getting our law enforcement different equipment and bulletproof vests and things needed. And I was very successful in managing those grants, as well as being audited by the government and passing with flying colors. So I know I possess the ability that is required by a commissioner. My heart is allowing the people to be heard. I understand I'm young, but I also know that I possess the knowledge and the capability to work with anybody. It was not a very easy decision to stop getting our meals from the hospital, because I know it costs some jobs and it costs some heartache, but it was best for the county and the detention center. I'm young, I'm very eager to learn, and I know that I possess the ability that you're looking for in your next commissioner.
My name is Don Thompson. Can you all hear me? First of all, I want to thank you all for coming tonight. It's very important to me to see this level of interest among the residents of Broadwater County. You need to know what your government is like, what the people are like. I have a background. I came here from Pennsylvania. Yeah, I know the state ends in IA, but it's not California. I have a very extensive background in local and state government. Back there, we did a lot of really good things. As soon as I say that, what's going through your mind is obvious to me. What you're saying is that was there, that was then. And you're right, absolutely right. That was there, that was then. I've taken the skills that I have, that I developed back there, to build a very effective Red Cross program here in the county. I've been the Red Cross guy for the last 8 years here. Very recently, we started a smoke alarm program. We've installed not just the Red Cross, but we've installed 350, roughly, smoke alarms, free smoke alarms, in residences from one end of this county to the other. So the Red Cross did not do this alone. We worked through the auspices, through the help of all the men and the women in the rural fire department and the city fire department. They're the true heroes of getting that work done. What do I want to do as a commissioner, should that happen? Way back when I was a kid growing up, they said, make a difference. Do something different. Help other people with your career. And that's what I've done throughout my career in Pennsylvania. That's what I'm trying to do here with the Red Cross. That's what I want to do with county government here in Montana, in Broadwater County. I've been very, very good at being able to improve the quality of management back with the agencies I've worked with in the past. I've worked with a lot of different Red Cross teams across Montana. So I'm doing the same kinds of things now that I did way back then. I'm very interested in public health and what's going on with Zeta. I'm sitting as an advisory member, temporary member, on the County Board of Health. I have a background in public health as well. I want to do the best job possible for the people of Broadwater County. And we're all looking at a time schedule here. You're all thinking that we have until maybe November to resolve this. We don't have that much time, folks. From my experience, my background in government, we have a very important date coming, and that's July the 1st. That's our fiscal year. If we don't have a budget in place by July the 1st, we are in deep trouble. All three county commissioners should be working on that right now. Thank you for your attention.
You You may have to bear with me a little bit. I've been under the weather a little bit, and I got a little bit of cold, but, you know, I'd have to say, my name's Larry Rickmeyer, by the way, and as I approached this tonight, I was a little bit concerned when I read the rules of engagement there that we were going to be working under as far as this forum or is concerned, and it kind of reminded me of something we've been watching on TV lately, and that's the Republican debate. You get 3 minutes, you get 30 seconds for rebuttal, so I've been sitting here tonight trying to figure out which one of these gentlemen that I need to attack and sling mud at. But having said that, I've come to the conclusion that, you know, that's not going to happen, and I just say that in jest, but there are people in here that don't know who I am, and take a few minutes to give you a little history. I was born in Townsend in 1952. I spent my childhood here, my adolescence here, all my adult life in Broadwater County, and I've always considered it just an unbelievable place to live and raise a family. I started out down here in Cecilia Hazleton Elementary School in the first grade. They didn't have kindergarten then. I probably needed it, but they didn't have it. And 12 years later, I might add consecutive years later, I came out the other end, and I've always been really impressed by the education and the level of education that I received here in Townsend. I graduated from high school, I went to the University of Montana, and then I went to Montana State University. I got married in 1971 to Shelly Iverson, who's now Shelly Rickmeyer, and that's, if my math is right, and I don't want to be wrong, I think that's about 44 years ago that we began the process and got into the ranching business. So I spent the last 45 years in ag. So I got a pretty good understanding of what goes on in the community, the history, and what it takes in agriculture and some of the challenges that are out there for the ag community. And I realized that agriculture is the economic backbone of our county. And we need to be mindful of that. So I spent 45 years, is my time up?
You've been close, you got 3 seconds.
Oh, well, we'll see, I'm almost up to where I was in high school, so the rest is gonna have to be quick. Anyway, I spent a lot of time in private business. We diversified operations, and we've been successful in our branches growing and prospered, and I think that's quite an accomplishment in this day. That's not that easy to do. Also on the public side, I spent 11 years on the local school board, and we had a lot of great accomplishments during that time. We built the school community library, we unified the district, we added on to the high school, and there was a lot of similarities between school board and local government and the way that commissions operate also. So I've got an understanding of government and how it works and the policies and the procedures. And I've been involved in the, you know, the hiring and the, anyway, I've been involved in all the facets of the school system. I think that was certainly well. I have some ideas on what I'd like to do for the county, but my time is up.
Okay, now I've got some questions that were submitted to the people that could not be here at the meeting tonight. And I'm just going to probably all ask these and then I will go back down this way. I'm trying to think. I think we probably got a 1 minute to answer this. Is that good? You ready? Okay. Here's a good one, or here's the first one. It is no secret that the current Board of County Commissioners is dysfunctional. Can you work with this, and what would you do to improve the situation? Larry, I'll start with you and come over down.
Do we need to stand up, or can we just... Okay, you know, that is a concern, and one thing that I will say is that The only person that you can really control is yourself. So how other board members act, I think it may be pretty hard to do that. But I think that the responsibility of a member is to take into account all the facts and do your job and try to bring the commission together, because after all, what we have to realize is that what the commission is there for is to do the people's business. And you need to be functioning. It doesn't mean you always have to agree, but you need to be a functioning body to ensure that the business of the people is getting taken care of, and that's a priority, and that's what the commission needs to do in about 15 seconds. So anyway, I'm not one to change somebody else's behavior. My approach would be to do the job to the best of my ability and lead by example and be inclusive and to make, to be transparent and clear about why I made the decisions I do, and then so that everybody in the county knows, the citizens know where I stand and the reasons I made those decisions. So, and hopefully that can resolve part of the commission problem.
Again, I'm Don Thompson. My experience back in Pennsylvania, I spent 12 years in Pennsylvania's governor's office. Most of the folks that worked there at the time would last 3, maybe 4 years. I was there for 12 years. I developed the very largest mandatory training program ever in the history of Pennsylvania. It impacted 43 agencies. Each one of those agencies saw themselves as the ultimate kingdom in Pennsylvania. They were the biggest and the baddest. I had to work with every single one of them throughout all of that process. Then I went on to do something even worse. Pennsylvania has 27,000 cops. I joined Pennsylvania's Police Commission. I organized training programs for currently serving cops. I don't have any more holes in my body than what I was born with. I've worked with the current county commissioners in the past on Red Cross activities. They're both really good people. I think they want to do the best that can be done for Broadwater County, and I want to help them do that.
You know, one of the biggest things, this is the big elephant in the room, is working with people. Over 13 years of law enforcement, you're working with a lot of difficult people. And one thing that I've realized in my career, and as a man here, is treating people with respect. I still address people by Mr. and Mrs., and I still handle myself professionally. And I believe that's the way that these meetings have to be handled, is handle each other with a level of respect, address them by Mr. and Mrs., and make sure that I'm doing, being very open with the community and the public. And I think that's what's lacking, is the openness with the public. One thing that I do plan on doing is being very open. I'm an open book. It's for the public, not for Nick Korthals.
First, let me mention Larry's name, because I know he needs an extra 30 seconds somewhere. Running the county government is pretty much mundane business. I can tell you that I've attended at least a dozen meetings in the last year. I went to see, why are we dysfunctional? What's wrong? And again, as Larry said, I don't think you can change people, but you can help them. Commissioner Obert's very organized and drives some meetings. I think I could help her, though, with transparency by making sure we have available the things she's talking about, so everybody can see them and have them. At the same time, and I'm not saying anything I haven't said to the commissioners already, to Franklin, I would love to help him. I'm not sure, he's a very thoughtful man, but I'm not sure he's a very gifted computer user. So making sure he has hard copies of what's coming up would be very beneficial for him, so he would know. And at the same time, making sure he's aware of what's happening in the county, so he doesn't feel left out. Both of them are great commissioners, but they both could use a little help.
Yeah, there's a lot of problems in the community with the commissioners not agreeing on a lot of subjects. I'm not a psychologist or anything, but I'm very open-minded. And I'm here to vote for the people, and I may not think it's right what I'm voting on, but you need to do what's right for the community.
I would have to agree that the commission is basically dysfunctional at this time, but I think that the problem that you have is people need to communicate and be willing to compromise. And I'm very, I like to look at most problems from both sides of the fence instead of sitting on one side and saying, well, this is the way it's going to be. And if you're not going to vote that way, then we're not going to vote at all. I think that you need to be able to listen to the both sides of whatever the issue is and make a decision in favor of the taxpayers, and that's the way you vote, irregardless of what your own personal feelings are. You have to be able to vote for the way that the taxpayers, they're your bosses, and that's the way that you have to vote. And you have to listen to both people's sides and possibly convince one of them that the other way is the best way to go. And that's really the only way that you can get things done, is to listen, communicate, and compromise. It's really the only way you're going to get things done without having a set way of, this has to be my way. Because my way, a lot of times my way just doesn't work for everyone.
Howdy, I'm going to just read something I wrote for part of the letter of introduction to the county commissioners when I was first thinking about running for this and had decided to. I realized that there are specific skills and knowledge that a county commissioner should possess. My focus will be towards that end, specifically to learn the ins and outs of being a public servant through diligent research of local issues, the laws that govern us, and the interfacing with co-workers and constituents. My goal is to earn the respect of my fellow Broadwater residents by my performance in fulfilling the duties of county commissioner. As far as Franklin and Laura both have my respect. I know that their heart is where it belongs. I don't feel like I'm in a position to critique them. I have a lot to learn myself. I'm looking forward very much to working with them and towards the goals of better our community. And that's all I can say on that. Thank you.
Second question. If there is an issue before the board that you are adamantly opposed to, later learn that it is the best solution to the problem, can you change your mind?
One of the skills that I always thought I had best was research. And the only way that you can ever make a decision is by getting as much information as you can on that subject. I always welcome that. I know, I think we all possess that. Listen to everyone say how open-minded we are, and I believe that. And yes, I can change my mind. I have done that. I like to think that I can approach subjects and have confidence, but I'm always there to answer questions and have things brought to me. There's a lot of people out there that ask on specific issues that have a whole lot more knowledge of an issue than I do. What better way to learn it is through them. That's how I kind of approach it. Thank you.
I wouldn't have any problem changing my mind as long as I get some straight facts. Now, granted, I may go into a situation and not have the utmost knowledge of exactly what's going on with probably an opinion already made up, but I'm very open to listening to ideas, and if somebody has facts and figures to back something up, I don't have a problem with changing my mind. And I change my mind quite frequently, actually, on a lot of things. And people have facts and figures to back things up that prove the point or what you would say the other side, and I don't have a problem with changing that vote or my opinion on what actually is going on there.
Yeah, I don't have all the answers and everything for everything, but if I'm wrong, then they can show me the better way and what the way it should be done. I have no problem changing my mind. and doing it that way. It's, you got to be open-minded in this job, and you got to be able to get the job done and do everything right for people.
Yes, I can change my mind, and often I don't know what's the right thing. At this morning's meeting, I wish you'd go to some commissioners' meeting. There was an interesting question raised. Someone wanted to talk about a political opinion and scheduled the meeting. It'd be a First Amendment right, possibly, to do that. At the same time, commissioners' meetings are a time to do commission business and not to bring in outside politics. I don't know what the right answer was this morning, and those things are going to come up. And I think, as others have said, it's a matter of keeping an open mind and being able to research. But you represent all the people in the county, and it's a difficult thing. So, yes, I could change my mind on things, and if later somebody doesn't ask me about the hospital, I hope somebody will, because that's going to come up as well.
I think going into this is the best opportunity is to be educated about what situations might arise. And you can't have every situation at hand. But if you're going into an opportunity with a closed mind and having one frame of mind, you're not going to get much accomplished, as we've seen over the last several months. So to change my mind would be yes, but that would have to say that my mind was already made up. The idea is to do exactly what I can't say that I'm going to be able to make everyone happy, because everyone knows that's impossible. But what's best for the community is what I would focus on. And even though that's a political answer, that's what I'm looking for, is to do what's best by the people, not best by Nick Korthals.
It's one of my core beliefs that the best decisions are made on the basis of the best information. There are ways to make decisions. You can grab a dart, throw it at the wall, put some answers over there. There is a way to process the information to come up with the best possible, defensible solution that explains why you made this decision. It's a process I tend to favor. If you go through that process, you don't have to change your mind a whole hell of a heck of a lot unless you give some additional information. And that can change the whole picture. So you get the best information that you can, you weight it, you value it, you make the best possible decisions, and if something changes, you've got to react to that. So yeah, I can change my mind. Thank you.
I guess to answer that question, you know, the first thing I think you have to be able to do is realize when you may have made a mistake or been standing on the wrong side of things as additional information comes in, and you have to make those decisions with the people of Broadwater County in mind, what's best for them, and certainly wouldn't have any problem doing that. But then the other part of that is I think as a individual and as a commissioner, you need to have some closely held convictions, and you need to be able to kind of once in a while stand up for them too in the face of some pretty blistering opposition. A case in point, I was on the school board, and the prevailing attitude at the time was this idea of inclusion, and I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I didn't feel very good about it. And we had administration at the time that I kind of allowed them, and I didn't stand by my conviction. Well, inclusion means everybody participates, they don't keep score, everybody gets a trophy at the end of the day. And to me, that's not facts, and that's not what life is, and at the same time, I let it go. And I've always thought back on that time that I needed to be open-minded, but at the same time, you gotta have some gut instinct to be able to stick to your convictions and what you believe, so.
How do you feel about county employees who handle toxic chemicals having to go to their homes to launder the clothing they wear while using these chemicals, and then having to shower at their own homes after using these chemicals?
First of all, anytime you're, you know, I'm a rancher, so we handle chemicals all the time, and it's a pretty precarious situation. And I think to have county employees without the proper facilities to take care of that, you're leaving the county up for the potential of a huge liability situation if somebody gets sick or something happens. One of the things you need to do as commissioner is to protect the liability of the county. So that's one of the things I would think about. We either have to have the facilities to do it right, to protect the health, or we need to find another way to do it, because we don't need to put individuals in jeopardy, and we don't need to put the local taxpayers in jeopardy. So.
Do any of you remember a place called Three Mile Island? I was there that day, on site, on scene, what happened. I've been in emergency management ever since. I've sat on the current county's local emergency planning committee, the LEPC, for the last 8-9 years. I'm a recording secretary for it. One of the things that I'm proud to say is that, especially lately, the LEPC has developed some very, very good plans to deal with hazmat situations. And we practice those things, we talk about those things. We don't want to be in the situation where there's a hazmat incident and folks do have to go home and do their own cleanup at home. And that's not great. We have a process in place. We have plans in place right now with the county to make sure that if there's a hazmat incident like the one recently up by Silas, that we deal with those situations on site. So you don't take those things home with you.
Thank you, sir. I think it's sort of exactly, I refer to law enforcement because I spent 13 years in it. I would expect, you know, some sort of, whether it's a clothing allowance or whether it's some sort of benefit to those men and women that handle that stuff that they can use for dry cleaning or a wash service. Or I know there's a shower at the jail that they can shower up, not in the jail, in the locker room of the sheriff's office. I'm sure that there's ways that we can think outside the box and help those people out that are handling those chemicals, because everyone goes home to a family. We don't want to pass something on to their family. So I think it's something that we really need to think outside the box, and we have different options that we can look at. So I think it's something that we would sit down and look at those options and see where we can share.
I can tell you, working for a large contractor, safety is number one. Every day before we start any meeting, it starts with safety. And employees think only as much about themselves as you think about them as well as your employer. So if you don't care if they're safe or not, they take that home. I have no idea why this happens, if it's hypothetical or not, but there's no reason why we can't find an answer for these kinds of things. You should start every day, especially if you're handling hazardous chemicals, with a safe work plan. You should have the right equipment. And in this county, if this is a true scenario, needs to be able to equip those people to keep them safe.
People's safety is first, I think. We need to protect them, and I wouldn't put myself in their situation if it wasn't safe for myself. So we need to have a place, a facility for them to clean up and wash their clothes and take care of things. And we need not to have them be in a, we don't want to hurt anybody. We want to keep the public safe.
I agree with all these guys that we need to have a facility available for these people, but also the county in an employee handbook should have in there that if you're handling hazardous material, especially if you're the department head, It's your responsibility to have those clothing and protection gear available to your people that are working with you. And for you, it's also your responsibility to ensure that these people are paying attention to that process. If you're going to go out there and you just think that, well, I can just spray this one weed and you jump out of the truck and the hose blows off and you don't have your gear on, that's your responsibility. We do have to protect them, but it's also that department heads and those employees' responsibility to pay attention to the process of what you're supposed to wear. And then people say, well, you're going to insurance for that. Well, that's great. But the problem is if you've got workman's comp insurance for that, it just keeps going up and up. Every time you have an incident, that insurance creases up and that comes back to cost the county.
Howdy. I don't have anything further to add with that other than to write it down. And if chosen to do this, it's to check into it. It's definitely worth looking into. We all do need to be safe.
Let's see here. The last question we have, let me see if I can find it here. Are you willing and able to explain a vote you would make as a member of the Board of Commissioners, especially a no vote?
Be willing to explain a vote as you name on the commission.
Okay, I didn't quite understand the question. Okay. Yes, I would. Matter of fact, one of the things that I really believe very strongly in of anything is that openness and straightforwardness, that's where I want to ride. I'm kind of excited if I am selected to do this. I do believe that although you have to leave a motion at the door, you still need a passion to do this job. And that's what I would bring to this. And I look forward to working and talking with all of you about your particular issues. So I have no problem at all explaining a yes or a no vote on any issue or how I'm looking at things at the present, so that letting you know ahead of time so that you can change my mind.
Again, I'd have no problem explaining any vote anyway, because if you're going to make a vote, you have to have an opinion or something that influences your process. I mean, just to say, well, I just thought the idea was to say no. If you can't explain your vote as a yes or a no, then you should just abstain from the decision. I mean, why would you throw the decision one way or the other if you have no reason or explanation to make that vote?
If I voted no, I have to have a responsible answer for you guys, so you guys would know why and the reason. And, you know, I need to be able to explain myself and let you guys know and let everybody know why. So.
Of course I would explain myself. I don't expect this commission to agree with each other, even when the third person is put on it. But it is certainly, as representatives of all the people in this county, if you don't know why someone's voting yes or no, I'm not sure you're a very good representative. Now, at the same time, I'll tell you that questions that sometimes come up have to do with personnel issues, and you cannot give an answer publicly to those things. So there are times when you just can't answer the question. But if there's a disagreement on the board on policy or something else, if you're not able to answer why you went against the grain, you're not representing the people.
Thank you. Being able to explain yourself in a way that you vote, I think shows how into the situation you are. If it's just no because no, like growing up, I said no because I said no. That's what I said. That's not doing our community a whole heck of a lot. Being able to be educated in the way I voted or the way I look at things only helps the communication between you and me and also the fellow commissioners. If I explain the reason why I voted no, maybe, as it was said earlier, maybe their viewpoint's wrong. Or if I voted yes, and if it doesn't sound good, then maybe I'm on the wrong side of the fence. But if I just say no, it's not, I'm not doing my job properly.
I first learned that I had to be able to explain my decisions on a particular date. That was June 7th, 1969, when I spoke my last two words as a free man. Figure it out. Yeah, I got married. And those of you who are, realize that, you know, you've got to be able to explain to your spouse why you made these decisions. Okay, well, that's what happens at a personal level, what happens at a professional level. I told you that I work with a lot of agencies and state government. Every one of them wanted to know why I did what I did. The best way to handle that is to get ahead of that process and build the other folks into the decision-making process with you. And then you'll be able to say, hey, you know, this is what we all came up with. This is what we felt was the right thing to do with the right information at the right time. But you don't have to explain yourself a whole lot. It's pretty obvious why you did what you did.
Okay, I guess I would kind of agree with Delge, actually Mike, I call him Delge, we've been around a long time. But anyway, I think this really comes into play when you have votes of, say that the commission is split, you have a yes vote over here and a no vote over here, and you're going to end up being the deciding factor in this on probably what could be a major issue. And if you vote no, you need to have very concrete reasons to explain to the people why you took that position. I think that's just a matter of being open and honest, and I think that probably would come up more in that situation than any, but I think you need to be able to justify and explain every vote, and your votes should always be tempered with what's in the back of your mind. What's the best for Broadwater County? What are the best for the citizens? What's the best for the taxpayers?
Okay, we've come to the point in time here where we're going to open the questions from the public. And I please ask you to please have the utmost respect for these people, because it takes a lot to put themselves out there like they are this evening and to run for an important job that's in our county. So I guess the rules are they will be given a minute to answer, and then, well, I don't know, I think we're just going to keep going with this, because moving that thing is going to get to be a lot of trouble here. I'm getting older. Public, you ask questions, I'll call on you, and 1 minute to answer. Now, we have a deal in here also, is if questions directed at a specific candidate will allow the 1 minute answer. If they involve another candidate in their answer, that second candidate will be given 30 seconds to rebut or clarify. And I think that's referring to the Republican deal. Okay, has anybody got any questions? Shirley.
How many of these people have filed for the position, and would not it be more continuity in the process if you had filed? And I understand that the filing deadline was today at 5. How many of you, Mike mentioned that he had filed. Anybody else? Good. That's good. Thank you.
Yes.
I have a question for Bill Uptegold. Bill, you're on the Broadwater Health Center Board, which the hospital has always depended heavily on the county for financial support, bill levies. As a commissioner, do you see any conflict of interest as serving on the board at the same time?
Sure, I had to be asked by another old board member, didn't I? My answer is no, but at the same time, I don't know for sure. So I have gone to MACO and asked for the legal answer. But for the interim appointment, just to make sure that there's no conflict, if I'm appointed, I won't vote on any hospital monetary things that come up, just so there's not a question. But at the same time, I want to tell all of you that the investment I've had in the hospital board is hundreds of hours understanding how the hospital operates, and the hospital is on the same team as the county, not a different team. It is the largest physical asset building in the county, is one of the largest employers in the county, and I can tell you that we try to spend the money wisely. There's been an awful lot of things written about the hospital that aren't necessarily true about the money. So do know that for right now, I don't intend to resign. At the same time, if I go through the election and I'm picked after the primary, that question's gonna have to come up again. But I'm waiting on MACO right now to give me a legal answer.
Any other questions?
I'd like to hear from each of you how you view the PILT funding that comes to the county and how you see that being used in the county budget.
Okay, I'm gonna go ahead and I'll just start here and go down and then come back.
If Larry agrees.
Thank you. In regards to the PILT money, that's a great question because it's such a area of aggravation. But we need that money stashed away for not necessarily rainy days because we have a lot of rainy days, but we need that money due to help us at the end of the year, shortcomings, major situations that come up, unforeseen homicide or things of that nature, things that you just can't plan for. So I think it's something that we need to really view it more as a bond than a savings account or a checking account, and really pay attention to how we spend that money, because it's not always going to be there. And if we spend it free willy nilly, we're going to have ourselves a hard problem in the future. So I see it as it being something very taken very serious and looking at how to spend it wisely.
If you don't know, PILT money is payment in lieu of taxes. It's the money that this county gets for all of the federal land that's around us that we can't charge taxes on. This county does not use their PILT money as part of their budget. They set it aside and use it for other things. Now, the short answer to that question is I think we ought to, we never know if we're going to get it or not either, but we ought to set up a budget for it, say what we intend to spend it on, even if we say part of this is going to be set aside for a rainy day fund, greater fails or homicide I had never thought about, but obviously the county has unknown expenses that come up.
Yeah, we need to save it for unknown events that we're going to have because we don't know what's going to happen in the county half the time. We can plan ahead as much as we want. But from day-to-day operations, we could have something pop up and we're going to need the money, so we got to keep it in the same place. So when we do have a problem, we have the money that we can use it for what we need to use it.
I would have to agree with pretty much everything everybody said here. The PILT money is money that, in my opinion, should be set aside for use of things that we do not foresee. The county sets a budget at the beginning of the fiscal year, and that is the budget. If you have a department and you're constantly going over your budget, then you need to do something with that department. The department head may have to make an adjustment. That's the way it is. I don't think that you should take PILT money and spend every dime of it you can get your hands on. As a part of the rural fire district, we've had offers for PILT money that were not, as I saw it, they were not a viable use for PILT money. There was already money in the budget that you could use for that purpose. And I don't think that PILT money should just be spent on every little thing that some department thinks they need. I think they have to express a proper need and use for that money. It's not just because it's something you want. It has to be something that you desperately need or have to continue your operation.
You know, having several businesses over the course of my life, I understand budgets. But as far as it comes from guilt and how it's being used right now or utilized in our county, I honestly can't tell you that. I need more information on that. As far as I know, it's being used wisely. I have heard complaints about different ways it has been used, but personally, I don't know that. I'd really like more input on it, on how it is being used, and I expect to get that, you know, through research and listening to the public and tell me how it is being used. But again, as of right now, I'm going to defer that till later time.
I think no matter how you look at it, PILT is tax money. I mean, we don't call it tax money. It's money based on untaxable property within the county. It could be right-of-ways, federal buildings, federal land. But that PILT money should be looked at as part of the overall budget. And, you know, it's nice to have a slush fund and set aside and be able to take care of some unknowns and contingency. But at the same time, if you have sufficient PILT money, I see no problem in using that in the budget to offset property taxes or whatever it might be, or a mill levy. That money is there for you, as part of the overall budget. So, you know, I'd want to take a look at that and keep my options open on the PILT money, not just say that we're going to do one thing or the other, but to kind of keep it, you know, flexible.
I totally disagree with my predecessor, flat out. No. PILT money is money that comes to us in lieu of taxes, as has been defined. Can we count on this coming every year? No. If we make it a part of the budget process, a part of our normal expenditures, what happens when the federal budget changes and that money no longer comes in? The answer to that is your taxes go up. I don't want to see that. The PILT money, in my opinion, currently, I could be wrong, convince me otherwise, should be set aside and kept for those emergencies that we need to spend money for. Like a couple, 3 years ago, remember the Chinook that hit down on the Lone Mountain Road area? Wiped out a lot of the infrastructure down there, cost a lot of money to rebuild those roads, paid for out of PILT funds. If we'd have put them in the normal budget, I don't know how those roads would have ever been repaired.
What I'm going to do now, I'm sorry. Go ahead.
That's all right, Barbara Kircher. I would like to ask Bill Altigo the question that he wanted to answer. Why do you want to be an interim commissioner? Help.
Thanks, Mom. I think I can make a difference. There's a lot that goes on at these commissioner meetings that's just everyday business. I first told you about my background. I have a lot of things, skill sets that are necessary for a commissioner, not least of all I really like our two commissioners, and I think I could help them get along. At the same time, it's going to take some work to do that. And I also want to say that, and this goes back to the hospital, certainly I know about the hospital, but as a representative, and I will not pick on the ag community, but I know from the hospital mill levy work that those landowners are the ones that get hit the hardest whenever we talk about doing tax increases. So I'm sensitive to that. So when they were asking, can you say yes, can you say no, when you sit in that meeting, you need to represent everybody. But I think I could make a difference for this county. I love Broadwater County. And when we get a chance to close, I'll tell you a little more about that. But thank you. Thanks, Mom.
Yes, go ahead.
My name is Nancy Marks. If there should come up a question where an employee has done something incorrect or wrong, and I am directing this to Don Thompson, what would be the procedure for disciplining that employee?
I think you asked about my position on discipline. Let me tell you where I'm coming from on discipline, on employee discipline. I think we need to have a very simple, very straightforward process that is applicable to absolutely everyone. That when an allegation of a wrongdoing is made, the individual who has been accused has the opportunity to defend themselves and tell the county commissioners, because we only have 80 county employees, a small group, tell the three county commissioners their side of the story. If their side of the story makes sense, fine, go on back and take care of normal business. If, on the other hand, we give you the opportunity to explain yourself and you huff and puff, try to blow smoke, then we turn that over to law enforcement. And we have two possible answers there once it goes to law enforcement, either innocent or guilty. If you're innocent, you get reinstated. You're made whole, full money, full rep, everything paid. If you're guilty, the suspension becomes a dismissal. And the suspension, by the way, is a suspension without pay. No pay, no benefits. Why? I don't like to pay for somebody doing nothing. Do you?
I know Nancy didn't ask you this question, but I'd just like to comment on it. We already have a process in place. We don't have to develop one. It's called due process, and everybody has the right to due process. So if you have an employee problem or something like that, the first thing you have to do is go through the process. I know on the school board, there have been personnel problems, some of them very egregious, some pretty major accusations flying around, and you have to have a calm head. You can't have a knee-jerk reaction. It's a process. You have to get the process, you have to gather the facts, and you have to base your decision based on facts. If you have wrongful discharge suits in a county or defamation suits because you overreacted and the situation might be fairly serious, those are liabilities for the county. And when I was on the school board, a wrongful discharge or some other case where you acted too quick and you didn't act on the facts and someone was falsely accused, I think at the going rate at that time was about $250,000. And I think the taxpayers can spend their money a lot more wisely themselves than for counties to be irresponsible in how they handle personnel matters. So.
Do you want to respond to that?
Just got a couple of real, real fast points. Number one, I believe that we need to have a disciplinary policy that is applicable to everyone and that treats everyone exactly the same. No differences. Doesn't matter who you are, where you are, what you did, what you haven't done in the past. We follow the same process all the time. It's a new process concept. But the difference that I see is that in instances where individuals have been suspended, there's two ways to do that. One is with pay and one is without pay. And my position is very simply, you get suspended without pay. If you're suspended, that means you're doing no work. And I don't want to pay for somebody to do nothing. If you are adjudicated, goes through the court systems, the court system says that you're innocent, we'll make you whole. We'll give you the money back. We'll pay for all of the prior necessaries. We'll give you your seniority back, no break in service. We'll make you whole. On the other hand, if the court system says that you're guilty, you're gone forever. And who made that decision? It wasn't me, it wasn't us, it wasn't the commissioners. The decision to do the wrongdoing in the first place came from the employee.
Yes?
I'd like to hear the other candidates' view on that question.
I'm all set. I'd have to agree with Mr. Rickmeyer. We do have a process. It's a good process. Coming from a situation here just recently with the county, the process was handled properly, and it was done in a right way. I don't want to say the right way. It was done according to their policy. So I think to follow policy leaves you in a good light, takes you away from a lot of liability. So I would have to agree with Mr. Rickmeyer on this, because there's enough liability. To add more liability would be just putting a nail in the coffin. So we have a good process. It's called the due process, and I have to agree with Mr. Rickmeyer on that.
I'm not sure I have much to add. I would, as a board member, you want to follow the employee handbook and do what the employee handbook has to say and follow that process. And at the same time, you probably have a human resources department that you're going to rely on to take you through a problem like this. As I said earlier, if it's a personnel matter, it's really something you can't talk about publicly. And unfortunately, in Broadwater County, things want to get in the paper and be tried publicly. But you need to follow what the community, what your handbook says. You need to follow what your human resources people coach you through to do.
You need to follow the policies and procedures that they got in place, but you need to have trust in your department head to have them make their decisions. You don't want to have to micromanage them. You want to be able to have them make decisions on some of the firing and stuff that needs to be done, unless it pertains to you to fire the department head or to take care of them. So.
I would have to agree with these gentlemen. The one problem I would have with Mr. Thompson's solution is that if you suspend someone with or without pay and then you reinstate them, in a community, in a county of this size, I think that you're still sitting, you're looking at a defamation problem, because everybody knows when everything comes to an end, everybody knows. And if you have a reputation and pretty soon your reputation is ruined by false accusations and you're proven innocent, irregardless, that still is hanging over your head. And in a community this size, that's always there. So if you're going to get into a suspension with or without pay, you've already, as far as I'm concerned, you've exposed the county to a defamation suit, because you've ruined that person's reputation within a small community. It's not like we're living in New York City where 100 million people don't know you, but 20,000 do. Here, everybody knows who you are.
I can't disagree with following policy. I've had to discipline employees before when we had a couple of different shops. But I do differ in just one area is when you are an employee, they deserve loyalty on your part too, in that sense. You don't want to win an argument by laying off someone or suspending them and them not having the means to live on. They can't, they, you know, and they lose by just time. And I don't agree with that. And over the years, many policies have been in place that I think evolved, worked very well. So in closing, I just think overall, I do agree with the policy, just a couple of minor differences.
Mike, you're on the fire board. If you're appointed interim commissioner, what do you see here? Do you think you need to resign that position as fire board?
I have had that discussion with several people. I don't know if you were simply an interim, if you would have to resign that position. If I was appointed commission and I did not have to resign that position, even though I am running in the election, I would not. I've been on the city council, I've been on several parks boards, and I gotta tell you, the Rural Fire Board is probably one of the best groups that I've ever worked with. And we did a project at Winston, and those guys, everybody in that fire department, every district that we had, they showed up on Saturday and Sunday and shoveled dirt and rocks and ran jumping jack compactors. And I'll tell you what, that's one of the best groups I've ever worked with. That's my toughest decision, is whether or not I resign that seat. If I was elected, I'm assuming I would have to, but as interim, I would have to ask Corey Swanson about what my options would be.
I have a question, Mike, for everyone up there. The commissioner's position has changed over the last 10, 15 years. It's no longer a position where you just show up one or two days a week for a couple hours of meeting, make a decision, and go home and go back to doing whatever you were doing. From talking to past commissioners and from MACO's own surveys and stuff, new commissioners generally put in 80 to 100 hours a week their first 2 years just to learn what's going on. There's a reason it's a 6-year term. It takes 2 or 3 years just to learn it. How many of you, I know some of you said that if you are elected or you get the position, you're going to retire, but that doesn't fit everybody that's up there. How many of you are going to be able to donate the time required just to learn the position and to do the job correctly?
Well, I agree with you. It's going to take a lot of hours. It's more than the 32 I saw when I read that. If you want to be a commissioner, right now, you know, my biggest deal that I do is I go a couple of months to Florida to see my kids, but. You know, I've got a couple of grandkids I really think a lot of, so I like to spend time down there. But I've already decided to give that up. Otherwise, I'm retired. I realize it's going to take a lot of time. And there's over 20 boards that you have to become acquainted with. Not just one, but different ones. And I realized by leading this, most of my time is going to be spent just getting to know everybody on those different boards, who does what, and the responsibilities. And also with the employees. So consequently, I agree with you. I do have that time and I'm committed to it. And actually I'm fairly excited. If so selected, I'm really looking forward to that.
I have a small construction outfit and my son is my partner and we would continue working. But at the same point in time, when you're elected to this job or appointed, you're not donating time. You're paid very well for the amount of time you put in here. I mean, it's handsomely more than what I make at my present job. So as far as donating time, it's not donating time. You're paid to do your job. And when you take a job, just like in my construction business, you go and you do that job that you're getting paid for. And the other part of that is my stepson is more than capable of taking my business over and hiring employees. And if I'm not ready to get out of that, then I wouldn't be filing for election and I wouldn't be applying for this job. And the other part, the other thing that I have always had a problem with is that there is not a nighttime availability for people who actually have jobs that have to go to work to make ends meet to have conversations with the commission board. And that's one thing that I would like to see addressed to some point of making commissioners available in working people's off hours.
I'm going to have to make some great sacrifices to deal with being a commissioner, get rid of, you know, the 20 years of service that I did for the people around here, for their jobs and my roofing, sagging, and trees and stuff that I do. But I'm willing to give it up. I got a nephew that will come in and help and take care of the business while I'm out there.
Ernie, if it's $100 a week, I don't want the job. I've worked a lot of my life 60 hours a week, and I get that part. In that 32 hours or more, I intend, and I said this earlier, to hold office hours and be in the office to make myself available. I also intend to go out to the different departments and understand how they work and ask them what their needs are and what they want to do different, so we can start to move as commissioners ahead. I've lived my whole life with, not my whole life, I've lived most of my working life attached to one of these things, which is email, phone, and text. So pretty much 24 hours a day, if it goes off, I answer it, and I'm accustomed to that. And as far as attending meetings, it's pretty much what I do in my life now. I attend for my company meetings in faraway places. I'm not in Ekalaka, I'm in Glasgow, or I'm in Hamilton, or I'm in Libby. But I understand it's a full-time job, and that's why I said I would retire from my other job.
I do have a family to take care of with this. I've thought a lot about it. My wife and I have spent many hours discussing what I would do to provide for my family. I have a plan A, I have a plan B, and I even have a plan C to make sure that I can designate the time that is required not just by statute, but also by what the job requires. Being in law enforcement, you're on call 24/7. Every day of the week, birthdays, holidays, it doesn't really matter. So I'm used to being on call, I'm used to putting a lot of time in to accomplish a job, and that's the dedication that I bring forth, is I'm there to accomplish a job, and I'll do whatever it takes to accomplish that job.
Throughout all my life, I've usually had at least two jobs at the same time. In the early 70s, I had an electronic business in addition to working for the state full-time. After that, when I turned in my 40s, what do a lot of guys do when they turn 40? You know, you get a mistress, you get a sports car, and I had to be different because I am a different kind of person. I kicked the bucket and I bought a farm. So I worked my own farm. I made my own hay, went out and busted bales, brought them in, put them up in the mow. I made my own grain crops. I had an average of 27 feeder beef. I had hogs. I had four dozen layer hens. I bred Dalmatians. All at the same time that I was running around the state doing my full-time job with the state. I know how to manage my time. I'm pretty effective at that. And I've always done it that way. I know how to work that clock. The clock's a big enemy, or it's a good friend. You gotta know how to use it.
excuse me, when I decided to, you know, throw my hat in the ring, so to speak, to have the opportunity to be a commissioner, I'll have to tell you, it's not a decision that I made lightly, because I understand from past experience and stuff the level of commitment, the level of dedication, the level of responsibility that you need to have to be a good, effective commissioner. And I thought about it a long time. And I decided that, you know, I'm at a point in my life where my workload isn't as much as it used to be, and I have, will have the time to do that. But I just want everybody to know that, you know, if I am the interim or would be fortunate enough to be elected commissioner, if I'm in, I'm all in. And I will do whatever it takes to get the job done, to get the facts, to gather the facts, to serve the people of Broadwater County. This is my home. This is where I live. I have a vested interest in this place. So,
you still got a question, Bob?
What do you think is the most pressing concern right now with the commissioner? And while I'm at it, I'll say to Mike, the telephone is always there, and I'll guarantee you, if you're a commissioner, you'll get a lot of calls tonight.
Yes, what's the most pressing concern for the commissioners right now? I guess the way I'd answer that is the most pressing concern for the commissioners right now is to bring that body together to be able to function as a unit. And it's not about personalities, it's not about anything else. It's about taking care of business and making sure that we're getting everything taken care of that's required for the county. So I see that as trying to bring that commission together and make it function better. No matter how you look at it, I have respect for both Franklin and Laura. That's not what this is about. The commission needs to have three members. There's a reason there's an odd number. Because sometimes things are contended, sometimes people have a different opinion. You need to have the ability to make decisions so the county can move forward. So that would be what I would see as the number one priority to start with.
Up front and early, I said something that may have surprised some of you. I was talking about the clock. The clock can either be our friend or our enemy. Right now, it's an enemy. We are facing an absolute deadline. It's not mine, it's not the current commissioners. We're facing an absolute deadline on July the 1st to have a county budget in place. What happens if we don't have a budget? The bills don't get paid. You know, that means that the police cars, the sheriff's cars you see running up and down the highway, they're not gonna be there because we don't have the money to pay for the gas. That might make some folks happy. I don't know, not me. But the bills don't get paid. People don't get their salary paid. We've got to get that budget in place quickly. And it's not something that you can be done overnight. We need to start looking at that process right now. We need three commissioners now working on the budget because it has to be in place by July the 1st. We can't wait until November.
There's a lot of issues at hand. If there wasn't a lot of issues, I don't think we'd be pressing so much to find a third person. I would have to agree, though, again, with Mr. Rickmeyer, who makes a great point. I think coming together as one group to do what you're elected to do would probably be number one. And not only that, just making sure that we're open and very communicative towards the public. I think if we can work together as a group, the budget stuff takes place. If we can work together as a group, those other issues that we're pressing and the clock's ticking against us comes together. But first and foremost, we have to be able to work together. And I think that would be the number one on the list, is being able to come together and work together for the greater purpose.
I think finding a third commissioner is the external thing we need to do, but during my interview, I asked them the same question, and what I was told was the budget. Both Corey Swenson said he hadn't learned much last year because of his absences, and he needed to learn to do a better job. I listened to Wynn explain how he was learning and getting his budget right, but internally, it's the budget for the commissioners. Externally, I think it's healing and getting the third commissioner.
Yeah, the Broward County Commissioners need to get along, but we have three districts, and they all need to be represented in this. And we also got the hospital and the school to look after as far as some of the major issues in our community.
I would have to agree with pretty much what everybody said here as far as the pressing issue here, I think, is to get this commission to actually function in a business-like manner and to get a budget in place, because if you don't have your budget, then you're going to be bare bones with everything. I think the other thing is that the commission has to get together and work so that the department has know exactly where they're going, because like I said, you've got 80 county employees, that's 80 people's lives plus their families that are on your back, so you need to give that commission back to functioning and get a budget passed to take care of whatever business that the argument seems to be about. Businesses need to get taken care of so that the taxpayers can understand just exactly where the county's headed to and what we're going to get done in the next year, so we're not sitting here in July and they said, oh, we don't have any money. I mean, it would be catastrophic like a hospital shutdown. That's the exact same thing we're going to have. If you don't have a budget, you don't have a third person, we're going to be 20 times more trouble than we are right now.
Well, this question is kind of nice to be last on. I do agree. It's just, it's true. But I believe who's ever selected by the commission, I really do believe they'll be on top of this, along with the other issues at hand. So, having said that, agreeing with everybody, what else to say?
If you would be elected as a commissioner, would you be able to, instead of if someone that one of your friends or a department that's getting a lot of money comes up and, oh, I'd like a little bit more, are you going to be able to say, I will look at all the departments and be very fair with the departments rather than cronyism? And I think that can happen very easy. My dad was a county commissioner for 14 years. He got so many calls from people who wanted the favor because they knew him. Are you going to be tough enough to work through that?
One of my strengths is being impartial. I really do like to know what's going on. And cronyism does bother me. A lot, I'm sure it bothers most of us, you know. Especially, maybe not if you're on the receiving end. But yes, that's one of I guess I'd call it a pet peeve that we all seem to have about that type of thing. Without being judgmental or if it's in place or whatever, it just still requires knowing all the facts before you make a decision, but definitely, definitely, keeping an open mind and then dealing with the issues.
I have a pretty serious problem with people appointing friends to positions, because the thing is that if you turn around and appoint a friend to a position or give that friend more money, then pretty soon it becomes, well, I want more, I want more, I want more. And the thing is, like I said, with the budget and PILT money, it's a process of needs. It's not a process of wants. And that's the way I think positions and monetary distribution of money should be handled. I mean, a lot of people want a lot of things, but it's not necessarily what they need.
They already have a budget set and in place, and I wouldn't play no favoritism to them, even if they're my friend. I would have to have a reasonable reason to give them the extra money. no favoritism, I put my foot down, and the money needs to go where it's supposed to go.
Well, two parts. First part, I already said on the hospital, if it came up, that I would recuse myself. But the second part, if I understand the budget right, is the general levy that's currently done is already distributed by how much each department will get. It's separated down into smaller levy pieces. So I'm not sure the commissioners have that ability to say, I'm going to give you more money. Now I have to, there's a lot for us to learn, any of us up here, but I don't think that's necessarily an option. At the same time, someone can show up and say, look, I don't have the right name for it, the piston on the lift is broken and we need to replace it. And that's not in our budget, can we get built money or not? Those are the kinds of things that I think commissioners face every day in the meetings and have to make balanced decisions about. But no cronyism.
In 13 years of law enforcement, there's been many a times where you stop someone and they're like, hey, I know you, just give me a ride home. Doing the right thing is not a problem for me. I have no problem with doing what's right and not to scratch someone's back. So to answer your question, I think there's a process to be followed, and the commission has to look at it and view it as, okay, what's the best for the county, not the best for one department.
My name is Don Thompson. There are a lot of Thompsons in Broadwater County. A lot of good folks named Thompson here. I'm not related to any one of them. Okay? So I don't have a family background to work with. I don't have any prejudicial attitudes towards one group or another. I've also worked in law enforcement. I know what that is all about. I've been challenged by 43 different agencies, state agencies, for my decisions. They have come after me with everything in the world you can imagine. I make rational decisions, and I'm very, very willing to explain my decisions, why I did these things. I'm not for any group, I'm not against any group. I have this need in my head to try to treat everyone as equally as possible. I'm a nationally certified ethics instructor. I try to pay attention to those things. Those are important. Deal with folks as you want to be dealt with. Very, very important.
If I got the question right, I think the main focus of the question had to do with cronyism and what goes on at that level. And I'll tell you right now, I have no tolerance for nepotism or conflict of interest at the county level. If I see it, I'll end it. If I think there's conflict of interest, I'll point it out, because I think, those things could just not exist in an honest commission. So no nepotism, no conflict of interest, which could happen. I would put an end to it.
Is anybody else? Okay, I guess in closing, what we're going to do is let each candidate speak for a minute and do a wrap-up, and then we'll be done. So we'll start with you again, Larry.
All right, I want to thank everybody for coming. It's been very intimidating, I'll have to say. It's not easy. I don't think for any of us to kind of throw ourselves out there and kind of, expose yourself so people can see all your flaws. But the question is, why did I decide to throw my hat in the ring for county commissioner? Broadwater County is my home. I've always felt blessed and privileged to live here. It's a great place to raise a family. It's full of great people, hardworking, conservative, tend to be a little conservative, and that's all good. What makes our county great probably isn't our elected officials. What makes our county great are the individuals that live there and all the people that volunteer and are willing to set up school boards and hospital boards and all the people that volunteer on the fire